I'm Alex.
And I'm Kris, and you're watching Thanks with Alex and Kris.
All right, today is going to be a little uncomfortable, but I like uncomfortable to a degree, so.
Right. I'm very good with uncomfortable and awkward. That's why I like The Office. So we're going to be talking about worst horror movie sex scenes.
Yeah. We're going there.
There's some really good ones, too, but that's not what this show is.
No. Mm-mm.
So if we happen to bash one of your favorite sex scenes, sorry, not sorry, I guess.
These are opinions, like right. We've always said, you know, whatever.
Right. So let's, I guess, jump right into it.
I'm just going to jump right in because, Jesus Christ, I have a couple that I'm like, So I'm going to go number five, Puppet Master.
I
don't know why it makes me so uncomfortable, but it just does. Like, I don't know, like, the scene where they were trying to do research or whatever, but they just end up fucking. It's like, right,
it's
I get it.
It's an awkward movie
to have. It's, you know, kinky or whatever, but, like, I don't know why, like, the mood just didn't feel, just felt weird to me. And which sucks, because it's like, it was Empire, I think, well, Full Moon now, but, like, you know, Empire Pictures. You know, when they made Puppet Master. So it's like, of course, you know, I mean, Full Moon, there's a lot of uncomfortable shit. If none of you are familiar with Full Moon Features, I invite you to please do some research
Check
on it.
Check their catalog.
Guys, like, their movies are so, like, so bad they're good. And it's all these cheesy B-horror movies. I am in love with Full Moon Features. I am fully invested. At one point, I did have the streaming service.
They have a streaming service?
They fucking do.
That's amazing.
Hell yeah, they
That's
do.
That's awesome.
Hell yeah, they do. And so, I even have, like, a Full Moon Features, like, hoodie. I love it. I'm obsessed. So, seeing this and being like, this doesn't feel
right.
Like Full Moon uncomfortable, you know, like, they tried to take it almost, like, too seriously.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah, in a movie like that, that's the thing
product.
Is, I think when horror fails is when it does try and take itself a little too seriously. Like,
yes.
Horror needs to recognize what it is.
Especially if it's Charles fucking Band. Like, Charlie Band, dude, like, you are amazing at your profession. Do not make it too serious, please.
You got this, dude.
Like, don't make it too serious because we love the shit. We love it. Like, oh, I fucking love Full Moon. Sorry. but I didn't care for the Puppet Master sex scene at all.
Yeah. The movie around it's good. I like Puppet
Master.
Oh,
Puppet Master's great. Yeah.
I like Puppet Master. But yeah, I agree. It's awkward. It's not fun to watch.
It wasn't the authentic Full Moon awkward that I was looking
for.
But then again, it was the early stages. So maybe they were just, you know, kind of playing around to see what would work and what didn't. And they did
And
learn.
That did not.
Yeah, right. Right. All right.
Number five. My number five, and this is one that's bothered me since I saw it in theaters, and it's Underworld Evolutions.
Okay.
And here it is. Okay. You've got, I'm in love with Kate Beckinsale. Like, any part of me that is gay, it is for Kate Beckinsale. Like,
That's fair. She's very pretty.
Oh.
She's hot. Yeah.
Scott Speedman's not a bad looking dude either. So you've got two beautiful people. A sex scene between them should have worked. She's a vampire. He's a werewolf or a lycan or whatever you want to call him. Should have worked. Should have been hot as fuck. It looks, they don't line, I hate when they do this, they don't line him up right, so it looks like he's humping her belly button the whole time. Like,
like the room, like Tommy Wiseau!
Exactly, exactly.
Does he know where her vagina is?
Right, I'm so mad about it because I love the Underworld movies, some of them, and I was so excited, and they, for the amount of skin they show and everything, you'd think they'd at least line him up right, like,
No, they did not.
Nope. And, again, I know that, you know, they can only show so much. I'm not sure. I think it was a PG-13. But they had taped him so much in that it almost looked like he had no dick at all. Like, I don't know. The whole thing, bothers me. Like, I don't mind. They have to bunker down because the sun's up. She can't be out when the sun's up. So, all right. They're passing the time by having sex. That all makes sense.
Yeah.
Fine. It's just the way that they have sex, the direction in that scene is not good. I can't.
I don't blame you. That does sound very uncomfortable. I've never seen it, but
it was disappointing more than anything because it was not as good a sex scene as I was hoping it would be.
All right, are we on to number four?
Number four.
So I am going to bring up Basket Case 2.
Okay, so I was going to put this on mine, but I didn't because I knew, I had a feeling she was going to bring this one up.
So Belial and Eve.
Yep.
What the fuck? You didn't have to show it, Frank.
Maybe they did.
Frank Headlong, you did not need to, we didn't need this. We didn't ask for it, most importantly.
Like, it's not a matter of need. I didn't ask for it, all right? You did this to me.
Traumatized. No, I don't mind it. No, it's so uncomfortable.
I know. Like, I don't mind it, though.
It's like, how? How?
No. Valid.
How?
Valid, no. But I didn't mind it.
It's a cool concept. Don't get me wrong. It's fun. It's fucking weird. I'm all about weird. I'm all about the good side of weird, guys. I'm all about it. But this is a little far for me.
It's a toe on the bad side of weird.
Yeah, exactly. It's flirting with that line. And it's fucking...
It's amazing.
Oh, it's God. Not amazing. And it's even like, accompanied by just, like, this, like, really shitty 80s, like, yeah. Synthesized romance music.
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, why? I didn't ask for this.
It's awesome. God, I love that movie.
Fuck. Okay. Oh, all right. That's all I have to say about that. Why and how, and I didn't ask for it.
Right. Well, we sort of saw how, but...
to a degree, but I don't want to think about it anymore.
All right. So my number four is The Return of the Swamp Thing from 1989, and yes. This is the sequel to Wes Craven's Swamp Thing.
Yes.
But Wes Craven is not involved in this.
Probably with right reasons.
So they actually said, like, this whole movie is weird, and they set it up, like, Swamp Thing has, like, this personality, and he talks like a normal person, mm-hmm. and, like, I don't know, I hate it, but Heather Locklear's in it, and there's a part where they're, like, in the woods together, and they're, like, flirting at some point, she's like...
Is there a Mrs. Swamp Thing?
No, I'm a bachelor.
And then
why?
And then he's trying to explain to her. He's like, "I'm not." What is his quote?
Why not?
You said it yourself. I'm a plant.
That's okay. I'm a vegetarian.
Guys,
you fucking Jordy Verrill from Creepshow.
I was dead. I was dead. I think I laughed for a full, like, 5 minutes. I couldn't. It's okay, I'm a vegetarian. What?
Again, how?
What? And then, what? It goes the even worse. Like, then he's got, like, some kind of growth, like a fruit or a nut or something that, like, comes out of him. And, like, he eats it, and then she pulls off a piece and eats it. And then it's, like, some hallucination where now he's a normal dude and they're getting it on. I don't know.
What does it
mean? I wish I could explain. I really do. I was not in Jim Wynorski's head. That's the guy who directed this movie. Direct all inquiries to him. But,
wow.
Yeah. My favorite part of it, though, is that's okay, I'm a vegetarian.
Who wrote this script?
Straight up dead. I'm glad they put that line in.
Oh, yeah. That's amazing. No. Honestly, it's that makes it right there. That really makes...
But,
scene.
Yeah, I please invite you, I'm sure that just the clip of it is somewhere online, look for just the clip, because you don't need to watch the rest of the movie.
You don't, but trust me.
Watch just this clip, because I can't even explain the absurdity of it properly. It's amazing.
I'm a vegetarian.
And amazing in a bad way, I'm gonna say.
Okay.
Number three.
So I actually handpicked this one because I remember seeing it, and not only was I very, very uncomfortable, but I was very confused, you know? So there is an episode of Tales from the Crypt, okay, called "Of Death of Some Salesman," and this is about, like, a sales guy who just kind of cons people into, you know, stupid shit or whatever. He's door to door.
I know which episode you're talking about.
Yeah.
Okay.
And they were talking about
took me a minute.
The cemetery plots, mm-hmm. and he was basically he was scamming people. Well, he goes to this one house, and so Tim Curry stars in it, and he plays all three of the characters, yep. like in this family. So he's the mother, the dad, and the young woman that resides there, and there is a very uncomfortable turn because they realize, you know, that, you know, he is scamming them. And they're like, oh, well, you know what? Our daughter's looking for a husband. Are you interested?
Yeah.
And they basically, like, kidnap him and they force him to, like, have sex with their, like, really gross daughter. And it was the most uncomfortable fucking thing I think I have ever, like, not ever seen, but it was up there on the list. You know, it was just, you know, yep. Like, it was awkward on all levels. Mm-hmm. On all fucking levels. It was just yep. Weird.
Try watching it with your dad. Because, yeah, we used to watch it. With our dad, when we were on weekends with him, I think it was Friday or Saturday night, Tales from the Crypt came on HBO, and we would watch it. That was one of our shows we watched with him, and yeah, so when episodes like that would come up, it would be extra awkward.
Well, and the thing, too, with Tales from the Crypt is, you know, since it was on HBO in the 90s, it had so much fucking sex. Like, I mean, I own all seven seasons, right, and I watched all of them. And, I mean, the amount of sex in those episodes, like, there was one episode I remember specifically, like, that shit might as well have been a porn. It might as well have been porn. It was the one where the guy gets the tattoo.
Mm-hmm.
He gets a tattoo from, you know, somebody, you know, who's like, oh, I know what's inside you or whatever, yep. You know. And he was, like, the rock star.
Yeah. Which,
hey, fun fact, I am going to bring it up because I'm a nerd. So, that episode was directed by William Friedkin, and William Friedkin made The Exorcist. And the band in the episode, they're called The Exorcists. And I did not realize it until I watched it, like, probably for, like, the second or third time. And I was like, oh, cool, William Friedkin, you know. And then they're like, you know, like, coming up is The Exorcists. And I was just sitting there and I was like, I see what you did ding, there, ding, ding. You know. It was really cool. I felt like such a pathetic nerd. But anyway, I digress. So, Tales from the Crypt had a lot of weird things to begin with.
Yes.
But, like, this sex scene was the one that stood out to me the most, which was weird.
I agree. That was a weird one. The one that sticks out with me the most, and it's because I think it was a little weird to see as a young child or whatever, but the one with Terry Hatcher where she's, the guy is, like, stalker, like, in love with her and, like, kidnaps her and takes her to the thing, and her dead boyfriend winds up coming to save her. But in there, like, it's not really a sex scene because she gets away before anything happens. But, like, he ties her down to the bed and he pulls out, like, a whip and she's in a lingerie. It's Terry Hatcher.
Is that the, like, the model one?
Yeah.
The photography?
Yeah.
Okay.
And he, like, either he kills her boyfriend or something happens and her boyfriend dies. But then he comes back. Before he died, he's like, I'll always be there for you or something.
Yeah.
And he comes back to life to save her. That's the one that always set me because that's... like, I don't know if that's why I'm so interested in handcuffs and shit now. Like, I don't know. The things you see when you're a kid that stick with you, you know?
It's so fucking true, though. Like, it's so fucking true. Like, it's you get, like, a couple glimpses of it as a kid, and then when your sexual awakening comes as a teenager, you're like, oh. You know? And it happens all the time. That's where a lot of, you know, I mean, because, yeah, when you're a kid, child psychology is fucking wild.
Right.
Like, I took a class in college, and wow.
Yep.
It really is fucking crazy.
Yeah, the things that influence you are just nutso.
Okay.
All right, so my number three is Slice from 2009.
Sure, okay.
It's a sci-fi horror.
Yeah.
But, so basically Clive Owen and Sarah Polley, I don't remember their characters' names, are like scientists or something, and they have a genetically modified human that they like breed or create or something, and they're the parents to it. And it was called Dren. Was it Dren? Yeah. That was the name of the thing that they and it was female. And so they raise it as their own, as their own child, right? Then when Dren gets to be a woman, like, I guess Clive Owen can no longer like stand it and winds up having, you know, sex with this thing that he's raised as his own daughter. Now, if that's not...
That's really gross.
...bad enough, later on, I do believe that Dren also, like, rapes her mom, Sarah Polley, as well. Like, so two disturbing sex scenes in this one movie.
Good Christ.
Yeah.
I don't, like, I saw
talk about psychology.
Like. Yeah, like, I saw, like, bits and pieces. I think probably I only saw, like, a trailer for it or something.
Yeah,
but I did not realize.
90, or 2009.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, okay, I would have not. Yeah. That, weird.
Yeah.
That's definitely on the bad side of weird.
Bad side of weird there. That's getting, it's strange, like, Schrodinger's cat of incest, because it is, but it isn't, like.
Yeah. That's, weird Schrodinger's cat, Jesus. Yeah, uncomfortable.
Yeah.
Uncomfortable, weird, awkward.
And that's how I felt watching most of that movie anyway, so yeah. I don't know, watch it for yourself. I always tell people watch it for yourself, but I wouldn't recommend Splice. At all. Yeah, that's one you can skip. Okay, so number two.
Oh, there's a little film made by Brian Usna called Society.
That's my number one.
Is it?
The shunting scene?
Yes! Yep.
That's for sure my number one.
Oh my god! Like, what the fuck? Like,
so gross, you guys!
What the fuck? Like, it's... why? Just... Listen here, okay? Screaming Mad George is awesome. He makes...
Love him.
Brilliant effects.
Love him.
He's definitely very, very good at making things very uncomfortable. And I respect that part of him so fucking much.
But no!
But I just can't watch it without feeling some sort of ick.
Like, I need a shower after I see it. Mm-hmm. Like, why?
You and need calling something.
It shunting, like, that's even worse. Like, the word they came up with, shunting, that's disgusting.
It just doesn't, it, anytime anybody would, if anybody ever said that to me, I'd be like, listen. You know, I was like, I'm not even going to ask because I already know it's going to be bad. So.
No, that's definitely my number one. So we'll skip, we'll go ahead and say this is my number one movie because ew, that's all.
Yeah.
Because ew.
I don't.
If you haven't seen it, just, again, I'm sure you can find just a clip. It's called The Shunting. Mm-hmm. Watch that clip. You'll see. And it's even more weird for me because Billy Warlock is a character in this movie. And, see, I didn't see this movie until later in life. Because it's from, what, 1989? Mm-hmm. So I was 4 when this movie came out. I didn't see it till later in life, so I had already started watching shows like General Hospital, and Billy Warlock was a character called AJ Quartermain on General Hospital. So when I did see Society, I'm like, AJ, what are you doing? Like,
oh god. No. Yeah, it's just fucking odd. Yeah, no, it's, again, I understand, like, the whole symbolism behind it and the themes. Again, I get it, but it doesn't make it any less uncomfortable for me to watch.
Right. You could have just described it. I don't think we needed to see it.
I mean, to be fair, if you're involving Screaming Mad George, I definitely want to see it. At least see it, but not react well to it. Right. You know? But...
no.
Grody.
Gross.
All right, so
my number two, I'm Jack Frost.
Oh, yes.
And I'm going to say, snowman rape, need I say more? Like, it's...
why?
It's not only... And it's a ridiculous scene to watch, too. I don't know. It's just so uncomfortable. And I put it under the same category. And any of these movies could have gone in there. The one with the turkey rape. Thanksgiving. One with the tree rape. Evil Dead. Like, you don't... rape is already bad and scary enough as it is.
Right.
You really don't need to add anything like that to it. Like, you don't need a gimmick.
No, exactly. That's a really great way to put it. You don't need a gimmick to, you know, church up rape, you know, for fuck's sake.
Like, Last House on the Left did it just fine without having a giant snowman or turkey or...
I spit on your grave, you know? I mean, and that's the thing. I was actually just having this conversation with somebody not too long ago about... violence and against women and like rape in horror films, and you know a lot of film, like, there's reasons why a lot of these films have those certain themes.
Right.
Obviously, if as a creator, as somebody who wants to be a filmmaker, and they want to address those concerns and they want to address those themes, you know, with whatever script they wrote, you know, that's fine. But you definitely have to do it tastefully, and you have to make sure that you are sticking with your actual theme, and you're not just, like, putting it in there to be like, yeah, why not?
A carrot moving down the body to become a rape instrument, not it.
Dramatic.
But yeah, Jack Frost, already a stupid movie because it's a killer snowman, but I can deal with that. Like, there's all kinds of stupid shit like that in horror that sometimes turn out to be good. Plus, I love how everyone confuses it with the other Jack Frost.
Yes, the Michael Keaton one.
It's amazing.
That one's shit, too. I hate that movie.
I really, really hope that, like, kids got confused and rented the wrong one.
Oh, no.
That'd be hilarious.
That's, okay, that's too funny.
I'm gonna have to look it up and see if that happened, because that would be hilarious.
I'm sure you can find that. I'm sure you can find stories like that all over the internet. Yeah.
For sure. All right, well, we already did my number one, so we'll finish off with your number one.
I'm gonna be real. I tried to avoid this one, but I can't. I need to talk about it, because coming from somebody like me who flew a little too close to the sun, was like, oh, you know, I love shock value movies, and I like to, I'm gonna be honest with you, I like to see how far filmmakers can go. That doesn't mean I like what's portrayed in those movies. I need to make that very clear, but I do, I guess in a sense, appreciate, like, standing back, right, objectively, I appreciate that there are filmmakers who want to really push buttons.
Right.
You know, that's brave, that requires courage. And I think, you know, those are good aspects to have in filmmaking because it's scary. You know, it's scary to, you're going to face adversity.
Put yourself out there.
Exactly. You're going to face adversity and there's going to be people who are like, you know, you can never do it. So really having that aspect as a filmmaker, like having that mindset is, you know, I appreciate that. Again, objectively. Doesn't mean I like the content they produce. So I'm going to bring up a Serbian film.
Oh, yeah.
Please. don't. I did. And I regret it.
I didn't watch it.
Please don't. And this is coming from somebody, again, like I said, who I appreciate when filmmakers really push over the edge. I like weird shit, you know? I mean, I can have that appreciation, but a Serbian film is not...
Yeah, I didn't even watch it.
Those are themes that should not have been made into a film. I'm gonna go there. I'm gonna say it. Those themes are way too heavy. Way fucking too heavy. Especially writing, you know, especially it being fiction. Yeah. You know what I mean? And that actually kind of bothers me in a sense a little more because somebody had to manifest this and somebody had to write the script and somebody had to think of all the things that went into this movie. That's what bothers me about it. It's like, it's one thing if it was like nonfiction, you know, I mean, it'd still be fucked up. Like it'd still be fucked up and I'd still feel like really fucking bad. But the fact that somebody had to manifest this into existence.
Well, I'm
to make
sure
it.
They probably picked and chose from different horrible news stories, and that's, I mean,
I'm sure
that's how Wes Craven was inspired for Freddy Krueger. Was he read some news story about some kid from, he was an immigrant from some other country, and he wouldn't go to sleep because he was terrified of some dream he was having, and he was scared that he kept telling his parents, if I go to sleep, it's gonna get me. And they finally convinced him to go to sleep. They hear him screaming, go into his room, and he's dead. He died in his dreams. And that Wes Craven saw that story, and that inspired Freddy. So you could, I mean, he could have, they, whoever wrote Serbian film, because I don't know any much about it, I was like, not for me. Whoever wrote it could have seen all kinds of horrible news stories from all around the world.
Oh, I'm sure.
And put it all together in his mind to create this. So it's not necessarily someone who's got a fucked up, you know, it could be.
Right.
It could be just someone who thinks of fucked up things and is like, well, I'm going to make a movie about it. But who knows?
Probably shouldn't, though.
Right.
You know, it's, you know, and it's considering the, you know, what the film is about, you know, I'm sure that filmmaker or writer or whatever, you know, was in that adult industry and probably saw some really fucked up shit, like shit that goes beyond kink, shit that goes beyond, you know, a fetish.
Well, they touch on that sort of, the snuff films and all that sort of thing have almost gone mainstream because look, in a fourth season of American Horror Story, Freak Show, Elsa Mars.
Yeah. Well,
that was part of her background, was she was part of those videos and that's how she lost her legs, as they cut her legs off.
You pulled that right from my fucking brain because that was the first thing I thought of was that episode.
AHS is always on my brain, especially Freak Show.
Yeah.
I love Freak Show season.
Freak Show's my favorite, too.
Same, yeah.
Yeah, that's the best one, for sure.
Yep.
Everybody loves Coven, and I don't get it.
I like Coven.
But
I do like Coven. But Freak Show's my favorite, for sure.
Hell yeah. We like AHS.
Yeah. We stand in this
we
house.
We don't hate this. Yeah.
Right. But that's exactly what I thought of for Serbian film. And I was like, oh, well, then I kind of already saw this with her. I don't need this. And Hostel a little bit.
Oh, for sure. Yeah, Hostel definitely has a lot of those same themes. But not as brutal as a Serbian film. Right. And by saying that, because Hostel is already pretty fucking brutal. So by saying this film is 10 times worse than Hostel, that's really saying something. But there's nothing specific in a Serbian film that I'm like, oh, you know, like this specific sex scene.
It's the whole thing.
Literally every single sex scene in there, every single one is incredibly fucked up. And the ending is even worse. You know, I mean, it's bad. It's not fun to watch. Even if you're curious, don't. Like, I'm seriously, I'm genuinely saying that from the bottom of my heart. Like, I'd rather bleach my eyes than watch that movie again. I swear to God. Like, if somebody was like, I'll pay you, you know, $500,000 to watch a Serbian film, I would, that's a lot of money, and I'm not gonna lie to you, I'd think about it, but it's 99.9% gonna be a no.
Yeah. Like, see, that's, I don't like that part of the genre. I appreciate it, I know it's there. I've seen Hostel, Hostel 2, I didn't see anything past that, if there were more, because Hostel 2 is pretty much my limit. I saw the first Human Centipede, and then I was, like, out.
Same.
That's just, that part of the genre, that little niche, is not for me. I know that it's for other people, so I'm not one of those people like, shut it down. No, it's, you know, have your little niche.
It's part of the genre, of course.
It's just, it's not my genre. So when I heard Serbian film came out and people were describing it as 10 times worse than Hostel, I was like, oh, this is not for me at all.
Yeah, don't,
at all.
Don't even get curious. Like, I mean, it's so fucked up, and it's sad and heartbreaking, you know, to see all that, like, all of that happening. It's really gross.
Yeah.
and it's traumatizing. I'm not gonna lie to you, it's a traumatizing film.
And that the fact that this stuff does really happen in real life, or did, or, you know, probably still is.
Or is based off of the true story or whatever, like a rendition of it.
Right, because,
like,
that's what also, they said, Ryan Murphy said that it was all based, every single person there, their backstory was based off of a real person in Freak Show. So, just, I don't understand the appeal. Maybe I'm not, because I'm not a masochist or whatever you call it, but I don't understand the watching other people be tortured as a turn on.
I don't get that either.
I don't get it.
Like, and that's a whole lot different than from, like, regular BDSM, too. Like,
right, that's a whole
so
other level.
Much more different.
Like,
you know?
I understand, okay, I can get why people would be turned on by spanking or, like, light whipping or whatever, but when you get to the point where you're watching a film about a woman getting her legs sawed off, how is that pleasurable for you?
That's, like, yeah, if it is pleasurable for you, you're probably very
go
mentally
to therapy.
Ill.
Go to therapy.
Yeah, like, you're probably a sociopath. Like, it's very likely that you are, you know, because that's a little too far, my dude.
Too far.
Yeah, that's a little too far. You know, and again, like, with, you know, there's a difference between, like, snuff film stuff and, like, actual BDSM.
Yeah.
Because BDSM there's, like, zero reflection of BDSM in, like, in terms of movies like
that.
Because the BDSM community is actually very caring and very,
and all about consent.
All about consent and aftercare, you know. And it's, again, it's all based on, you know, like, a fantasy and a kink. You know, they're not like that, you know, in real fucking life, you know.
Right.
There's an amount of respect, you know. But when you have movies, you know, that portray, like, the really fucked up shit like that,
right,
it's like,
yeah, I don't think it's fair for the BDSM community to get
not
wrapped
at all
up in that stuff.
And they get shit all the time. And it's, you know, it's not good, you
nope.
know. I only say that just because I know several people who are involved
I know
in BDSM. Yeah, so it's like,
I didn't think
from
I did,
I
but
hear,
then I thought on it, and I was like, oh no, I know a couple.
Right, so it's like hearing, you know, like, stuff from them, you know, and it's nothing of what people fucking think. So when movies like that come out and they portray, you know, things like that, it really does kind of give a
I would like to see a better movie, because from what I read the first book, I saw the first movie, and then I was like, this is stupid. The 50 Shades of Grey.
Ugh.
And everybody in the BDSM community has said how horrible those movies are, how they're not a good representation. I would like to see a good representation come out.
Absolutely.
That shows what that community truly is, you know?
Absolutely. Yeah. I agree, you know, because it's really not as, like, you know, weird or shitty as people think it is.
Right.
I promise you it's not, you know, so.
Yeah, because I'm not opposed to sex scenes and sex in media and all that. I mean, that's a part of life. That's, yeah. It's just natural.
You're going to be exposed to
right.
it. Yeah.
So, I don't
And you might
care
as well let
that.
Your freak flag, you know, fly.
Right.
Like, honestly, like, if it's something that's how you feel, if that's what your fantasy is, good on you.
Yep.
Just
as
make
long
sure.
As it's not hurting anybody.
Exactly. I was just about to say, as long as you're not hurting yourself or anybody else and it's all consensual and you're having fun. You know, that's what's important, kids.
Yeah.
What did we learn today?
Consent.
But yeah, fuck a Serbian film. Don't watch it.
Yeah.
Just don't.
We'll
just
end with
refrain.
That. Don't watch that movie, please.
Refrain, please.
Yeah, I won't. I won't ever watch that movie. Like I said, I saw it and I was like, no, that's not for me.
So I flew too close to the sun, and of course I was like, I love seeing fucked up shit. And then after that, I was like, I don't think I like seeing fucked up shit as much as I thought. It really made me reflect on myself and take
right.
a step back.
Like, why did I do this to myself?
I'm a much better person because of it, I'm not gonna lie, but it's sad that I had to get there to do that, but anyway.
So, that's what we think about bad sex in horror movies.
Yes.
One of these days we'll have to do, like, an opposite day and do things we love and do favorite sex horror sex scenes.
Hell yeah!
Because there are some good ones.
I don't
There's some real good ones.
Oh, 100%. Yeah, I'd be so down, of course.
Yeah, when's opposite day? Isn't there, like, an actual opposite day?
I wouldn't doubt it. I'm pretty sure there is, though.
No.
I'll have to Google it.
We'll just do it when we want.
Thanks. We love it.
Right.
Yeah.
Thanks. We love it.
That'll be fun. I'm totally down to do something like that.
All right, so that's our show. Please like and subscribe. Make sure to ring the bell so that you get notified for all of our awesome content when it comes out. And thanks for watching.
Thank you. Appreciate it. Love you. Kisses. Bye.
Good night. Goodbye.